And it looks like our players do have their opening hands, their basic Pokemon set out. Let's see those ever important prize cards here. Hopefully neither of the players prizing anything too relevant. Six prizes being laid out.
Oh, two Snorlax in the prize cards.
Yeah, and that Mimikyu as well. That's actually a card that can be a big deal in this matchup.
And Nathan prizing two copies of that electric generator.
Yeah, not too big of a deal. Normally, you would hate to see two electric generators in the prizes as Maridon, but you kind of take a slower approach in this matchup, really just aiming to manually power up, hopefully a Maridon. You know, that's what your best starter is as Nathan in this matchup, is just getting a Maridon into the active spot and going from there. And yeah, just attach to it three times and start swinging, start taking KOs, start dealing with these Snorlaxes. Yeah, Dennis here might have a little bit of pressure laid on him thanks to the fact of a pair of Snorlax being in the prize cards. Now, he does play one copy of Hisuian Heavy Ball, so that can fetch that one of those Pokemon out of the prizes, and he's also got Pionia in this list as well.
Lots to talk about, lots to get into as we are set up and ready to start. Here we go, finals match for the Masters TCG here in Vancouver, and it will be Nathan starting action off with that Maridon EX in the active. It's one of the Pokemon you're okay having down against the Snorlax deck, and already filling the bench up using that tandem unit ability.
Yeah, I'm a little interested to see a bunch of Pokemon coming into play right off the bat. You normally don't need to be too pressured to put a bunch of Pokemon into play, but one strategy players can employ against this Snorlax deck is to just fill the bench with Pokemon they're okay having in play to try to play around the eventual Erica's Invitation, sticking something into the active, like, you know, maybe something like a Flaffy in this specific matchup, or that dreaded Squawkabilly EX.
And their key card comes down right away. Talk to us about this chip. Why is Spiritomb so important here?
Yeah, Spiritomb is a massive card for Nathan to put into play right away. It's fettered in Misfortune ability, means that basic Pokemon VM play have no abilities. So Dennis normally is setting up his deck with the Rotom V, using that ability to draw three cards to end your turn every single turn. You're not a player that's... You're not a deck strategy, excuse me, that's aiming to, you know, attack every single turn. You're usually just passing with your Snorlax active. So you might as well, instead of pass, use that Rotom V ability. And you can't use that Rotom V ability thanks to the Spiritomb being in play.
We do see one of those two electric generator in the deck. Does only find one lightning energy. It's not too bad, though. You want to slowly get this powered up. This deck is playing a ton of energy. 14 lightning energy and one double turbo. We also see that double turbo in the hand. And this game is all about resources, and here's an attachment we don't see a lot. Double turbo energy coming down onto that Maridon EX.
Yeah, not too big of a deal, to be honest. Dealing 200 versus 220 into a Snorlax, it still means it'll be KO'd even if a Bravery Charm is attached.
We will see Nest Ball kick things off for Dennis. Has not yet had a Rotom V so far, so that can come down. We know that. Besides the Snorlax and the Mimikyus, there are no other Pokemon in the prize cards, but that's also got to be a pretty important note here for Dennis going through this deck on the first search.
Yeah, and we just saw immediately Dennis kind of realizing, hey, I've got a couple Snorlax prized, and because of that, Hisuian Heavy Ball is brought right to the front of the deck. And that is one thing that can be an issue for the Snorlax deck in this matchup. You know, you need to be able to have a replacement Snorlax every single turn if you're anticipating your active one being KO'd.
Well, this start looks excellent for Dennis. Has access to the Arvin in the hand. Already saw that Battle VIP pass. Now, Battle Pass has a lot less value here, though, because two of those Snorlax are prized. They are not available.
And you can, of course, go and get the Rotom out of the deck, but like we talked about, Spiritomb means that will not be an option to draw cards. So Hisuian Heavy Ball definitely seems like a better choice here. The Bravery Charm, pretty interesting. You know, you can throw it on the Snorlax, but it doesn't really protect it from being KO'd by something like the Maridon EX.
So we'll most likely see one of those Snorlax get grabbed out of the prize cards. But this is sort of an issue about this Snorlax deck. You really kind of struggle to consistently put on a lot of disruptive pressure when you cannot end your turn by drawing a bunch of cards, filling your hand up. Dennis will get the full news of these prize cards. See that a couple of those are priced.
And as opposed to getting the Snorlax here, I almost wonder if Dennis is just going to grab the Mimikyu. And he's really thinking about it. And you can see this is this is a tough call. The Mimikyu is pretty good in this matchup. There's only a couple things Nathan can do to hit it. We did see right away Nathan grab the Zapdos out of the deck. That is one option. And then another one is to use Mew EX's Genome Hacking. You can use that attack to copy your opponent's active Pokemon's attack. So even though Mew is a EX Pokemon, it can copy Mimikyu's attack, which places damage counters. It doesn't do damage. It places damage counters. So those are the two ways that, Nathan can deal with the Mimikyu. It does seem like Dennis has decided to go with a Snorlax, however.
Triple Snorlax in play, and a pass of the turn over. And there is a few interesting pieces. It does have that Lost Vacuum in hand, but that could be honestly a pretty big deal to not use that to get rid of something like the Squawkabilly. Instead, it's going to hit the discard pile, and that's really not something you want in play.
Yeah, but with the full bench right now, I don't think you mind it too much. The thing that could come up is if at some point Dennis uses a counter catcher to bring up a Spiritomb. The only real way that Nathan has to move that out of the active is to use its fade out attack, which pops it back up into your hand, which can be pretty solid. But if it comes back to your hand, that leaves an opening for Dennis to go for something like the Echoing Horn.
Does find that lightning energy, though. So there it is, Photon Blaster taking the knockout on Snorlax. And this is a very tough spot for Dennis. Does have another copy of that Arvin.
Has a counter catcher as well. Mm-hmm. I feel like targeting down the Zapdos makes the most sense. It's not a super efficient attacker into the Snorlax. Its electric ball attack deals 110 damage. So it's a two-hit KO, and that's something you can withstand thanks to the 150 HP on the Snorlax.
So the Nest Ball, the choice of the item. We will just see another Bravery Charm potentially. I'm not sure if Dennis has that Forest Seal Stone yet. That is a piece you can still use with something like the Pidgeot V, but putting Pidgeot V in play is also not great because you're also blocked by that Spiritomb.
All of Dennis's Pokemon V to put in play really don't seem super strong. It does find the Luxurious Cape. It's kind of a catch-22 with this card. It does give the Snorlax 100 more hit points, so boosts it all the way up to 250. That means it will not be KO'd by the Photon Blaster of a Maridon, but it does mean that the Snorlax gives up two prize cards when it is KO'd.
Now, Maridon, usually a great attacker, but does have that effect on that Photon Blaster that it cannot attack the following turn. So, well, 200 damage in a burst is solid. It's almost like you're doing damage over time sometimes because you're just passing turns back over.
Yeah, and we literally might just see Nathan immediately pass. I don't know. It does look like he actually has the Forest Seal Stone. He's got a few cards actually worth playing here, Electric Generator being one of them.
Does hit two energy off of that, so it's just going to be prioritizing getting Maridon powered up. It's the most efficient attacker at taking one-hit knockouts onto the Snorlax.
Yeah, even though you're attacking every other turn, it is still one of your best options here. You can KO a Snorlax even with a Bravery Charm attached. And so having that as an option definitely seems solid.
So the most interesting thing I'm thinking about here is will we continue to see energy drops, but it's going to just be one more electric generator. So this one doesn't hit any lightning energy, but for the two that you got off of the previous one, I think it's a fine trade-off.
Yeah, Nathan definitely needs to be mindful of the energy attachments. He's got 14 in the list, plus the one double turbo. We already see that has been attached. With a ton of Pokemon in play, you want to make sure your energy cards are not spread too thin.
Already starting to power up this Mew EX, and just saying go. Have fun with it, passing the turn back over. As we're going to see a Giacomo discarding this double turbo energy. That will force another resource out of Nathan this following turn.
Yep, one of the only energy removal options in this deck, discarding a special energy from play. Ends up working out pretty decently here for Dennis, and now has Countercatcher and is debating what to use it on. And it will be that Spiritomb, and this lines up a potential problem for Nathan. Using that Spiritomb's fade out does move it from the active spot, but that would give Dennis an opportunity to use Echoing Horn to bring something like that Squawkabilly from the discard pile into play, and that is an excellent target to stick in the active spot.
Does find that Four Seal Stone, though, off the top of the deck. And this is now an interesting choice. Do you still commit to not using fade out, instead using one of your precious resources, one of those switching cards? It will just be the switch grab. There's already energy in the hand.
Yep.
And I think even holding on to a Peony, if push comes to shove, you do have to discard your entire hand, but sometimes it's just worth that if you are getting the resources you need to continue putting on aggression.
We will indeed see that switch. Nathan Beck really wanting to put on the pressure. A great strategy when playing against the Snorlax deck, especially when they're not able to utilize Rotom to stabilize. Dennis here with no great basic Pokemon options remaining in the deck. Two Snorlax in the discard pile, one remaining in the prizes. Just one Snorlax against the world at the moment. Can he find a way to pull this off?
This is tough. It's going to have to commit the Luxurious Cape. You are surviving a knockout, but even that Raichu on the bench, if you can somehow get some energy cards onto it. Now, a lot of these electric generator have been used, so I'm not sure in one turn it can just kind of come out of nowhere and take this knockout.
Yeah, it's definitely possible, though. Like you mentioned, that Peony is in the hand, so that can find something like the electric generator and escape rope, and then you only need to hit one energy from the generator. Nathan could win the game this turn.
We'll see. I think the last generator might still be in the prize card.
That is a good point, yeah.
We're going to see off this Ultra Ball what pieces are available. So let's take a close look. Let's see. There is that escape rope, but no electric generator. And speaking of switching outs, that is the last switching card left in the deck, is that escape rope. We're also keeping track of the energy. So far, double turbo down and six lightning energy are in play. So still plenty of ways to power up these Pokemon.
For Nathan here, a probably fine play would just be to attach an energy for turn to the Raichu and pass. You're not super pressured at this point to go aggressive. You know, using an escape rope to not take a one-hit KO doesn't seem super strong. Also, using Fade Out does open up an opportunity for your opponent to just potentially win the game with some sort of Echoing Horn play. So we will see that energy being dropped into play. And I guess you may as well use the I guess you can just at least use Mew, right? Draw a couple cards and then Peony is an option next turn.
Yeah, we're just going to see sort of a bluff here. Nathan's saying, I really don't have anything. I'm just going to keep attaching. And we're finally going to see Nest Ball, and this might be last resort. I think Dennis smells what's coming the following turn. May have to put a Pokemon into play, even considering Crabominable. I guess out of all of your V Pokemon, that's probably the best one to put down if you can't take the Pidgeot out of play and you can't draw cards with Rotom.
Yeah, I actually... not remembering 100%, but I'm pretty sure Crabominable is weak to lightning, or is it weak to metal?
I think it's weak to metal. It's
is
nice
it weak to
type.
Metal?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So that will be something that can soak up a hit, right? You can put Bravery Charm on it as well. Mm-hmm. I think it has 220 HP, so with the Bravery Charm, you do withstand a Photon Blaster, but actually having to use the Forest Seal Stone means that you can't even, you know, get that Bravery Charm as an attachment.
So one card of Dennis's choice coming to the hand. V-Star power used for the game here for Dennis. But I'm trying to think in my head here, Chip. There's no real one card that bails Dennis out from what looks to be pretty tough. And
yeah,
it's going to be a 50-50 here. Going to Peonia hope to find these Pokemon that are in the prize cards. Let's see what Dennis takes.
Yeah, there's no one card that helps him, so he has to use Peonia to find three of them.
And does find two excellent cards, the Mimikyu and the Hisuian Heavy Ball. But now comes the hardest choice with Peonia. You got to put three cards back as well. And there's not a lot of cards in the hand, and you want all these resources that you can keep.
It did get the Heavy Ball at least, so that can find another Snorlax. Mm-hmm. An easy send up off of a potential escape rope. Now, one other thing to mention about putting the, you know, Crabominable into play is that that becomes a boss's orders target for Nathan. Of course, the thing that makes Snorlax so annoying is its block ability. That is what is preventing something like the Spiritomb in the active spot from simply being retreated out of the active. But if you use boss's orders and bring up the Crabominable, you can attach, retreat, and then take two prize cards thanks to its 220 hit points.
Finally going to see Peony come down. Any two trainer cards can come into the hand for Nathan.
Yeah, we could see that Pokemon Catcher come up. Nathan did discard one, but has another one in the list, and that is what he is debating here. A 50-50 shot to bring up the Crabominable and get yourself the retreat option. Would need an energy card still to retreat his active Pokemon. So that is also another thing worth noting.
Yeah, smart choice there to also grab the escape rope. The only really way that Dennis can get rid of that card is if it's in the deck with Misfortune Sisters. So
right,
making sure that it's safe may come down to just having that last switching card to get him over the finish line in this first game.
Now this
big flip heads.
Now this is a big draw here. Yeah, this is a little risky, to be honest. He needs to find an energy card in order to retreat this active Spiritomb. Otherwise, it's an opportunity for Dennis to just use Penny to pick up this Crabominable, and I don't see the energy card here.
No, really not worth playing that escape rope either. And it's just going to be a pass over. Can Dennis find a penny. There's only a couple cards, but has the Switch card in hand. That's a big find. That's going to be one more resource out of Nathan's Book of Tricks to be able to bring this Crabominable up and let him sort of switch one of these active Pokemon that Dennis is trying to trap out of the active spot.
Yeah, Nathan is probably thankful to see that it was a Switch card and not a penny picking up this Crabominable, because that Crabominable now will stay in play. That means Boss's Orders can find it later on.
Good thing that Escape Rope was grabbed. Not going to be a danger of being discarded. Dennis does play that Misfortune Sisters. Getting rid of Ultra Ball, not too relevant. You're okay to have those cards get discarded. This turn is passed back over Nathan. One card too late, but now does find that Lightning Energy.
And with the Mimikyu being active, can still retreat this active Spiritomb. One thing, however, is there's nothing that can attack the Mimikyu, so we actually will just see the fade out. Bring the Spiritomb up to the hand. Dennis, though, only has a couple of cards in hand. Nathan really just taking a risk here, saying, I don't think you have it. You don't have Echoing Horn in those two cards in your hand.
See what this deck truly is when it's not able to consistently draw cards without that Rotom's instant charge ability. We are just going to see the penny, though, so that does pick up that Crabominable. A great play Nathan had lined up was Boss's Orders in the hand. That Zapdos' Lightning Symbol ability would have boosted this up, and now we're just passing back and forth. But this is good for Dennis to slowly build this hand up. Do we see another energy, though?
We do.
And I think it's time for Nathan to put on the aggression. We're going to see the retreat into the Mew. It does discard that Lightning Energy. It is a resource later on to keep track of. And here we go. Genome hacking, copying the Mimikyu, placing 7 damage counters on it. Now, thanks to that Bravery Charm, it is out of range of being knocked out for the moment, but one more of those genome hacking and it will be knocked out.
Yeah, Mew is honestly a pretty solid attacker overall in this matchup. It knocks out the Mimikyu if there's no Bravery Charm, and it actually also knocks out Snorlax if there's no Bravery Charm, because Snorlax's Collapse attack deals 150 damage. You do have to flip a coin to see if you can wake up, right? Collapse does put you to sleep, but you've got two opportunities to do it, right? One's going into your opponent's turn, and one's coming back into yours. So Mew, honestly, when I've played this matchup, Esmeraldon has been one of my go-to attackers.
Just going to pass the turn, accepting Mimikyu's fate. It will go down this turn to another genome hacking. And Spiritomb comes right back into play. That was the one window there for Dennis to maybe shift the momentum into his favor.
Yep, no Echoing Horn able to be found. Dennis forced to send this Snorlax up. Has a counter catcher in hand. Probably brings up the Zapdos here. That 2 retreat cost, the 3 energy requirement in order to be able to attack. And there are quite a few energy cards in play right now for Nathan. A couple in the discard pile also.
I believe we're at 9 total in play, so there are still 5 energy remaining. And trying to do the math, so if we put 3 on the Zapdos and then 1 on each of these Maridons, there's technically 1 fewer energy in play. I believe there's not enough that one Pokemon could get stranded.
Okay, here we go. This is the last switching card. The Escape Rope now being played from Nathan. Does force the other Snorlax into the active. This one has that luxurious cape. Nathan having to debate what to send up here. Could just go with the Raichu in order to take 2 prize cards on this Pokemon. Would have to discard a ton of energy cards from play, though. Is this worth it?
It feels so risky. Maybe if you still had one more switching card left, I would get behind this play because you can at least pivot that last time.
I mean, Nathan knows that Dennis's hand is not great. He's not been using Rotom. He knows 2 of the cards in his hand are 4 Sealstone and Crabominable, right?
Yeah.
So this sets up for the win on the next turn, forcing Dennis's hand. Dennis has to find a response right now. Otherwise, he will immediately lose to this Raichu. Does Dennis find it?
And it's
a penny!
Picks
up his only Pokemon in play. Honestly, you gotta respect it. Dennis going out on his own terms, and Nathan here gets the win in game 1.
An ode to the 2015 National Finals of AZing up the Wailer. A respectable way to go out. Wow. I mean, look, it just sat there, it did nothing. It was just staring menacingly, but it was that Spiritomb that was the MVP of that match for Nathan. Really just did not allow Dennis to put together much of a strategy at all with that draw being shut off.
Yeah, really solid game planning, I think, here from Nathan overall. Dennis maybe got a little unfortunate with those prize cards, forced him to go for that Hisuian Heavy Ball early, but really it was the Spiritomb is the big deal in this matchup.
That Pokemon catcher could have definitely made things a lot worse than they ended up being, but the end of the day, Nathan had just enough resources to go for that aggressive play, a little bit of a gamble, but it paid off dividends, allowing Nathan to knock out that Snorlax with the luxurious cape with a big dynamic spark attack from this Raichu and finish it up by doing it one more time. Nathan going up 1-0. Will he become the third player to, or the second player to win a North American regional? He's the fourth player to make it to a final so far this year with Maridon. Will he be able to take it home once again?
Yeah, Maridon has been excellent thus far this season. Will it cap off its time in the E block on the E on format with one final victory as we head into EUIC?
And one thing that we have to continue to take note of here is that clock. Now, we've only cut off about 20-ish minutes in this clock, but that was sort of a weird game. That game didn't really last a while. As we continue to progress through, the clock is only going to benefit Nathan. The clock is Dennison's biggest enemy here in this finals.
Yeah, we definitely need to remind the viewers at home about how the time rules work here in Top Cut. Now, normally, if you get to a game three situation, right, let's say that Dennis finds a way to win this game, you know, is able to lock Nathan up, you know, get a Flaffy stuck into the active spot, something like that. Dennis eventually wins, decks Nathan out. We go into game three, say there's, you know, 15, 20 minutes left. The game lasts for quite some time, and Nathan is able to take a prize card or two. As long as Dennis does not deck Nathan out before the end of those plus three turns, it becomes the first player to, you know, be ahead on prize cards, and that would, in that instance, of course, be Nathan. You know, Dennis only plays one single energy card, and it's for that Crabominable's attack that does zero damage, so we would not expect to see Dennis take any prize cards.
Well, we're getting right back into things. Here we go. Game two, Nathan starting off with a Nest Ball, and you're considering, do I just grab Spiritomb and put that into play before I get down Maridon and set my board up with Tandem Unit? But decides that it's a little bit more important to make sure my Pokemon are in play. Will be the selection off the Nest Ball, Maridon EX, Tandem Unit, and immediately grabbing another Maridon and a Zapdos. I think those last two bench slots are probably going to be for what we saw last game, Spiritomb and that Mew EX.
Yeah, but with the shuffle of the deck, okay, actually Nathan's saying he's going to go back in here. I was wondering if that meant that there was going to be no other Pokemon search available here, but it does look like Nathan has an Ultra Ball. This can go get the Spiritomb now. The problem here could be that I think the best cards to discard in hand here for Nathan are a pair of Pokemon. This is opening up a one-turn window here for Dennis to potentially find an Echoing Horn.
Yeah, out of all the Pokemon to be Echoing Horn back, Iron Hands is not the worst.
It's not the worst.
It does still have that Arm Press attack for 3 energy that does 160 damage, and there it is. Feathered in Misfortune back online. And hey, talk about Fast Charge. We can get some more energy into play too.
Yeah, the rarely used Fast Charge on the Raichu V. Actually putting on quite a bit of pressure here, threatening a knockout next turn with the Dynamic Spark. But what does Dennis have available in this hand?
I don't think there's anything really going on. A penny? It's just going to be a pass. Has to bench the Rotom to not lose the game by having his lone Snorlax get knocked out.
What is happening here? Dennis even throwing the Rotom off the table. You know,
he over-circuited. He short-circuited.
We're about to short-circuit back here because this is a tough spot here for Dennis. Now, did put that Pokemon League headquarters in play. That can be another piece of this puzzle that we haven't talked about yet that can be annoying for the Maridon deck. It makes all basic Pokemon's attacks cost one colorless more. So that means that Nathan is going to have to commit extra energy cards to each of his Pokemon if he wants to attack or find, of course, a counter stadium.
And these generators are big. The more energy they find, the more pressure Nathan can put on this turn, but does find 2 energy off of both generators combined. And there is an energy card in the hand, so we could be seeing Dynamic Spark take out the only Snorlax in play on turn 2 of the game.
Yeah, that would be a pretty aggressive line. I don't know if that's necessarily worth it, however, because if Dennis just finds something and is able to stabilize, then you run the risk of just having too many energy cards already being discarded.
We're thinking about it. There is also a switch in the hand, so could
there's also a boss's orders here, so you could go this route and just capitalize, make sure you take 2 prize cards, and that's exactly what Nathan is doing, giving Dennis the one-turn window here. What does he find from the top of the deck? It's a Nest Ball. That's a pretty good one, and he's also got a Countercatcher in hand.
Does get another Snorlax down into play. was debating maybe if Mimikyu would come down to maybe buy a little bit more time, but hey, this is the whole strategy of the deck, right? Block your opponent's active Pokemon, not allow them to attack. There is a counter catcher in the hand. So I think Dennis is just debating, do I try and buy some time? And the tough thing is, bringing Spiritomb up if you don't have a follow-up is really just not a play. It just only buys you one turn, and it will be the Zapdos brought up into the active spot, and we're going to be Psyleaning. It's a double Tails.
Wow.
Not able to bring back any card. Would have loved to at least get another Nest Ball to maybe get one more Pokemon into play next turn.
Now Nathan draws for turn, finds Peony. That can be a great way to, you know, go through the deck and find a switch card and put on some aggression, but no, is just going to pass it back and forth.
I don't think you can afford to put that Lumineon in your discard pile if you do not have the guaranteed out to put Mewiex into play. And with this Ultra Ball, I think Nathan is now going to finally maybe start using this Peony. A little bit of a heads-up play. Nobody's going to get overzealous. You've got to understand your lose conditions, and that Lumineon is not your friend in this matchup.
Yeah, I don't know that he, if he had another Nest Ball to guaranteed grab off the Peony, maybe didn't have another one available, so just chose to play it safe and was rewarded by finding Ultra Ball just the next turn.
Does use that restart, does have a switch and an energy, just commit the energy to Rhydon, and we're just passing back and forth. This is going to be this kind of a game, but this is okay. Nathan is okay to just keep attaching energy, use restart over and over again. We will just see some of these tool cards come down. There's no reason to really just hold them in your hand. And this is sort of how this game is developing, back and forth. Look at these top decks, though, keeps finding energy cards off these restarts, and here we're going to see it. The switch into this Maridon, and it's just going to be...
Nope.
Oh, can't take a knockout. Okay. Wow, but wow, committed that switch. That could be
That's a big
little
deal.
Bit of a big deal.
Yeah,
if
the Pokemon League HQ catching Nathan here a little bit. He actually had Peony in hand, and it would have been a pretty nice turn. Okay, this could be the opening. Dennis needs to fight back and get back in this game. A little bit of a misstep for Nathan, burning one of his only three switch cards a little too early.
Does now have to discard that Boss's Daughters. That could be a valuable card later on in the game. And there is only two switching cards left in this deck. We'll see if they both get grabbed here off of the Peony. I wouldn't hate that. I think also grabbing probably a stadium card as well,
guarantee,
so you don't have to
guarantee
the attack. You can also put an energy card somewhere where it's more efficient, so you can attack later down the line. So this place seems fine to Nathan. You can play Peony another time, maybe get that escape rope.
Yeah, Nathan had the Peony in hand with that switch, so he very easily could have just switched, played the Peony, gotten the Beach Court, and then even another switch card, right, to guarantee that it was safe. That would have been pretty strong last turn, but, you know, got caught, you know, not quite keeping track of everything. You know, that Pokemon League HQ slowed him down.
Energy now being placed onto that Zapdos, understands it's gusting target number one, most likely. Snorlax goes down, and what does Dennis have to respond? It's the same situation, it feels like, as last game. A couple of V Pokemon you do not want to put into play, and that Forest Seal Stone. Dennis is yet again with his back to the wall, down a game in the Masters Division Finals of the Regional Championships. Things are not looking good. Does at least have the counter stadium. It's better to not let your opponent have that Beach Court. And Crabominable again comes down, and Star Alchemy is used. What one card can bail Dennis out of this tough position he's in?
Yeah, a replacement Snorlax for when this first one inevitably gets KO'd. It actually looks like Iono is being eyed up as well. That could be what Dennis just has to go for. You know, a hand refresh, knows that these three cards he's got remaining are really not working for him. So let's find six more and just hope that that gives him a few more plays.
Now, this isn't terrible necessarily because, of course, the Maridon did use that Photon Blaster attack last turn.
Cannot attack this turn.
Can't attack, so kind of give yourself six cards. Hopefully you can find something to work with a little bit better. Not even worth playing that Palpad. No real supporters to put back into the deck. Maybe the Boss's Orders, but it's just not worth burning that resource this
early. Yeah, he's still got plenty of counter catchers at this point, so it doesn't really need to worry about it too much right now. Did find another Iono for next turn, but I think that's about it.
So we're just confirming everything has been used properly, and passing the turn back over. What does Nathan have off of these four cards? This is actually a very solid hand here with these four cards.
Yeah, he's got that Forest Seal Stone, has a pair of energy cards, and also the Peony in order to discard the hand and find a switch card if he wants, but doesn't really feel pressured to do any of that right now. Just chooses to pass and knows that this Photon Blaster will be live this coming turn.
Does find an Arvin, looks like, off the top of the deck, so can now grab one of these tool cards to maybe put yourself out of range of being knocked out by a Photon Blaster. Luxurious Cape, that will do it, as well as a Nest Ball. And now the choice is, which Pokemon do you put down? Do you put Mimikyu into play, or do you just get another Snorlax into play, and it will be that Snorlax hitting the board?
Yeah, we'll put that Snorlax down. Mimikyu's kind of tough whenever your opponent already has an energy on the Zapdos. That's a pretty quick and easy way to deal with it. We will see the Bravery Charm be an option. Luxurious Cape hanging out in the hand for a moment. And the Counter Catcher going to hope to stick something active here. Will it be Spiritomb once again?
Considering the Maridon, I don't hate this. It's not able to attack for a couple of turns. And I mean, time is what Dennis needs in this position to get himself back into this game.
Yeah, eventually hoping to lock something into the active spot. Nathan draws for turn, and it actually does yield the Escape Rope.
But this is tough to play this Escape Rope down.
He could.
It's going to be your last switching card, so it's a little bit tough.
He does have the option to boss his orders in a future turn with that Crabominable being in play. That's something to think about.
Could always be pennied up, so that's always
the fear
you got to think about.
It is a risk. It is a risk.
So, pretty simple choice. He can never really bring the Crabominable up here. It's just a free two prize cards for your opponent, it feels like. And they're just going to go down to one prize. All they need is just one attack to knock out your Snorlax, and they will become a regional champion.
Yeah, Nathan sending up this Maridon EX. It's set up to be able to take this knockout. Does put this Forest Sealstone into play. One more prize card for Nathan Beck. The draw for turn from Dennis is that Misfortune Sisters. Not going to help him out here. Has to go for the Iona.
And this is tough because you're not playing Penny, so that Crabominable is just going to stay on your bench, a huge liability. Let's see what Dennis can potentially put together. Maybe another Counter Catcher card.
You know what Nathan drew for turn?
What did he find?
Pokemon Catcher.
Could it all come down
to this coin flip right now? Pokemon Catcher.
Let's see it.
Flips the coin.
Heads.
And it is a heads that brings up this Crabominable retreat into the Raichu and Dynamic Spark taking the two prizes. Nathan Beck, the Vancouver Regional Champion.
Doing it with Maridon going all the way. Your last E-Block Tournament Champion is Nathan Beck, finally becoming a Regional Champion, and congratulations to him.